healthcare system is broken, but it doesn't have to be. This is Revenue Cycle Optimized by Infinix Healthcare. We discuss the latest challenges in the revenue cycle space and provide actionable tips on how to overcome them at your organization.
Welcome everyone to another episode. This is where we explore the latest challenges, developments, and innovations in the healthcare revenue cycle space. I'm your host, Stuart Newsom. I'm the VP of Marketing here at Infinix, and today we'll be discussing how to combine tech and team for success. I'm thrilled to see many of you joining us to delve into this topic today, as it's really revolutionary, so to speak, in healthcare management. So integrating technology with that consultative point of view or that consultative perspective and mindset is not only to simplify the process, but also to enhance the compliance and revenue cycle management significantly. So in today's session, we're going to explore practical strategies to leverage EMRs and automated systems in ways that profoundly transform coding practices by minimizing errors as well as bolstering compliance. We'll also discuss the rule of three in the root cause analysis, which is a method of identifying and mitigating common sources of errors and denials. This approach will be critical in helping us understand how to automate checks can be seamlessly integrated into existing systems to prevent recurring mistakes. So moreover, we're also going to tackle the often frustrating world of denials. We've been talking about denials. Denials is a reoccurring theme, and it's always a problem. It's really top of mind. It really is what drives a lot of revenue in the revenue cycle. Learning how to resolve them quicker and more effectively is what we're really going to discuss today, with some ongoing education and robust support for our coding teams. This will empower us not to fall into the trap of repeatedly appealing the same denials, which we all know can be both time-consuming as well as costly. We're privileged to have with us today Christina Arkins, our Senior Client Services Manager for ERS, the end-to-end RCM company of Infinix. She's a distinguished expert in the field who will share her proven strategies, and she has best practices that she's bringing to the table for incorporating these consultative approaches into certain operations for RCM management. Christina's insight will guide us in how to proactively address coding and billing challenges, paving the way for a future where technology and consultation coverage converge, I should say, to enhance the accuracy and efficiency of every claim process. So let's dive right in and learn how we can lead our teams into this promising future, ensuring that our operations are not only efficient, but also ahead of the curve in compliance and effectiveness. So how are you doing, Christina?
Doing well. How are you, Stuart?
I'm doing well. Very excited that you're here, because I know this is one of those things where when people talk about tech and team, people really focus on tech only a lot of the times, and it's going to solve all of the problems, so to speak, in the world. But then there's also issues where they forget the human part component of that and how the balance is when it looks at that from that standpoint. So very excited that it's I don't think many people talk about this. It's often forgotten. So happy to have you with us to talk about it further.
Yeah, I'm excited.
So get right into it. I guess investments in EMRs and automated systems. What are some of the most effective ways you've seen that these technologies reduce errors in coding practices?
I think one of the most effective ways that I've seen to see a reduction in denials, maximizing the utilization of an EMR, is to create rules within the system, right? And a lot of people forget that the factory settings of an EMR, they can be modified, right? They can really be broadened to cover what you need it to. Add rules in there that are going to relieve your staff of trying to memorize everything that has to happen for Humana, Aetna, Cigna, for Dr. A, Dr. B. Use your EMR and your clearinghouse. It doesn't have to start with your or stop with your EMR. The tools and the equipment that you have, build into them, really expand them. And so many people forget to do that. Your setup isn't going to be completed all at once. As your rules change for insurances, make sure that you're utilizing those systems to do the work. And so many people forget that, or it's overwhelming and they don't know how, where do I start? All of those things. And I'm so excited every time I see almost a clean slate in an EMR, because I'm like, yes, let's build this, right? How do I how do I relieve my coders of trying to remember all of these coding rules?
Right, exactly. And that's so key. I think it's more, to me, it reminds me of something I've been preaching for years, is that proactive approach earlier on in the process of the EMR, even when the patient access, where the patient's being registered and things that could be automated at that level. So it's really throughout the process being proactive, where you're inserting these rules and catch them early where they can be corrected, rather than with the denials, where then you got to go back and investigate what's going on, what is the root cause, and then make the correction.
Yes.
So essentially, that kind of segues into, as I mentioned earlier in the introduction, we were going to explore the rule of three with root cause analysis. And this is kind of where this trend is so important. It's almost like the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. Yes. It's almost like, why not correct it? Why not set yourself up for success? So I think you're going to elaborate a little bit on that now. Can you explain how identifying and addressing these root causes early can transform a healthcare organization's operations?
Yes. So you're right. So I think that so many times you create this hamster wheel atmosphere, right? We get these denials. We know they have to be appealed. We get these denials or remit responses. And we know that we have to send it to coding for review, or we need to send it to pool medical records so that we can submit those with the claim. And it just becomes a relentless hamster wheel of a cycle, right? You're doing the same thing. You're just waiting for those responses so that you can react appropriately. When you do a root cause analysis, even at a very basic level, a root cause analysis of determining, why am I getting this, right? Why? And I think that so many of the teams that I work with get so annoyed with me because I'm always asking the why. Why? Mm-hmm. Why are we doing this? Why are we That's doing so that? Important. And it's not because I don't know, but it's because I want you to know why you're doing this. Why are we appealing this claim? Why are we doing this over and over again? Creating an atmosphere where you can truly break down your remit responses, categorize them, and understand where to start is one of my favorite parts of working on this side of healthcare, because I love the investigation. I like to break down my root cause analysis into three kind of subcategories, right? So when we look at a remit response and I say, okay, why do we have this? Why is this the response that we're getting? Why is this the move that we make? Why am I receiving this response? And is it because of a payer, a person, or a product, right? Is Aetna just going rogue and continuously denying this, even though our claim is perfect? Is Mary Sue in my coding department just not remembering everything that has to go into billing and coding for these services? Are we missing a modifier continuously? That would be a person, right? Do we have all of our checks and balances in place, but my EMR is glitching and not sending over that original ICN on a claim, and therefore we're getting a denial even though we've done everything correctly? So if you split it out into those, I think that it really opens a window into, okay, now we know we have a product issue. Let's dive into that. Now we know we have a person or a human intervention issue where we need to do some extra training. Or, like I mentioned before, let's add some rules into the system so that we relieve the pressure of them having to remember all of this. And in turn, we resolve that denial. We're no longer on the hamster wheel, right? We're not going to continuously appeal these and wait for those responses. We're proactively going to put this in place so that we eliminate that denial.
Oh, nice. Yeah, exactly. And I like how you broke that down, because when you mentioned earlier, people just don't know where to start. And a lot of times when you don't know where to start, then you don't start at all.
That's exactly right.
And I like how you break it down in those three areas. It really simplifies the process. And then you can then hone in where to go, because we all know these CARCs and RARCs for these different minutes advice can be very vague and ambiguous. We know that they can mean different things across the payer landscape. So interpreting them. So you have to really break down, okay, you have to translate, what is this like? And so I think that's where the frustration is. So finding out that root cause, and many times it's the same thing over and over and over again. And to your point, if it's the payer, Are they denying this over and over? Well, they may find a unique way of denying it differently, but they're
That's
still
exactly
denying
right.
it for the same problem.
That's
but
exactly
now
right.
they may change it. So at any rate, I think you break it down perfectly in how that approach, just to make it more, a simpler process. So with that said, have you found most successful in implementing automated checks? And we're talking about automated checks. I know that there's, you know, claim scrubbers, editors that will alert you and flag you. Those are very important. But then there's also some of the automation that comes into play that prevent common coding mistakes. And how easily can these be integrated into existing systems?
Yeah. So figuring out, you know, every EMR is a little bit different. Each one of them has a little bit different, what I call brain power or brain space, right? Some EMRs can get down real deep and they can allow you to create rules, alerts, notifications by entrance, by CPT code, by policy number, right? By prefix for your Texas home plans for Blue Cross Blue Shield versus Arizona and Michigan, you know, all of them, you can get real specific in how you create some of these and automate those processes for your staff. And other EMRs are a little bit more limited. You know, you can still create those alerts, but you need to get more specific and detailed in what you're putting into that alert because the EMR has a more limited brain space. Mm-hmm. And so all of it is possible. I've never worked in an EMR where it's just, hey, you can't add anything to us, right? This
right,
is just who
right.
we are. And even if you do have some pretty stiff limitations in your EMR, the chances are your clearinghouse is going to allow for some extra brain space there, right? So I call those two things together. That's putting their heads together, right? What you can't do in one, definitely do in the other. And what you can do in an EMR, also do in your clearinghouse. Create those rules so that you have multiple layers of caution tape and multiple layers of protection for yourself in place so that if your EMR decides to act up on a Monday afternoon and not spark that alert for a coding rule, your clearinghouse is going to catch it. Your coder might not have noticed it. Your EMR might let that bad boy pass through, but let that clearinghouse catch it also before it actually goes out the door to the insurance. Rules like modifiers from registration, making sure that you have a rule set up for what insurances require a prefix. If your registration isn't done right, it doesn't matter how great or excellent your coding is, it's not going to result in revenue. So creating those rules from the very beginning point of when that patient enters the system to the very back whenever that claim leaves the EMR. And the same thing in your clearinghouse. Create caution and alerts from the time that claim, the time that loop segments hit that clearinghouse to the time it goes out to the payer.
Yeah, it's excellent. And I find that too with a lot of CFOs of large health systems or administrators of larger groups. I was recently at a state HFMA here locally to my residents, and that was just the theme. They were all asking how they can build in automation, and they're leaning towards some third-party vendors, you know, to do that. And I know that that's something that we've been ahead of the game at, where mm-hmm. we build a lot of automation within our platform. But we also have this automation that's readily available. If that's all you want is that one automation, we have lots of automation in our solutions, whether if it's patient access as well as our AR denials management platform that help that platform through a lot of processes. But we also are able to distribute a lot of that automation because that's what CFOs are demanding. That's what practice administrators are demanding. That's what
right.
RCM managers are demanding. Is I just want
right.
this one thing. Okay, well then let's do that one thing. Because it's really, as you were stating, you know, putting in a lot of these processes can be very daunting, can be very overwhelming. And even if you have the most limited EMR, you can go to clearinghouses to do that work. But you can also do some third-party vendors that actually can contribute to that. So
right. Yeah.
It's really, and with AI, because the payers are using AI now.
Yes.
And I think that the healthcare world is becoming more educated with AI, that it's just very important to start, you know, get on the AI bandwagon And if you can automate it, if you can use artificial intelligence where you can, and again, I tell everyone it's not replacing humans, it's augmenting humans.
That's so, exactly right.
Yeah. And with that, education plays a big part of this, you know. So I wanted to just kind of discuss the role of ongoing education and team support for resolving denials, because, you know, the rules change, right?
Yeah.
What are some of the key lessons your teams have learned from not having the appeal, or not having really to appeal that same denial repeatedly?
Yeah, you know, I think I've seen a variety of things with, okay, now we know that we have this in place, right? We're no longer having to worry about adding the appropriate modifier for this specific service that's being built out. We know that's going to process. What do I do now, right? Where do I fall? Well, we know the rules with billing and claim submission in general, those change so often and so quickly. And knowing where to find the information so that you can modify your rules that you've automated and put in place, modify what utilization you have for the FTEs that you have, making sure that you are setting yourself up to proactively pivot as you need to as the rules change. And that's where we use a lot of our time whenever you talk about, now we're not appealing these relentlessly. What do we do? How do I stay aware of what's coming? You know, subscribe to your top payers, at very least, your top payer bulletins. Be aware of what modifications your EMRs are undergoing throughout the quarter and the year. If your EMR is set to have a big upgrade at the end of the year, what is that going to entail? Right? Is that coding specific position? Is that more set for my registration staff? Where are those going to be? And what rules do we have in place right now that might be impacted? And it takes a lot of group effort. It takes a lot of teamwork to stay aware of what is impacting coding versus your AR follow-up, your registration, your front desk. All of it has to come together in this one nice happy family. I call it like, right, let's meet at the dinner table.
Right.
What's impacting like you today? What have you dealt with today? And making sure that you're not doing something or neglecting something that you think is only going to impact one area, but really down the line, it's going to impact your claim submissions and your revenue.
Right. And doing that across all departments and everyone that has as a stakeholder in the revenue cycle.
Yeah.
That, I mean, that includes the physicians. It includes not just the coder and the billers, but you know, the intake, it includes everyone. And to me, I've always said, hold everyone accountable. No one should be above the rules and hold them accountable, make sure the data is correct.
That's exactly right. Yeah. And I think it's, you know, understanding that everything has to flow and work properly in order for things to work properly. Right. So like your registration has to work well and be done correctly in order for your claim to go out correctly and get paid.
But just finally, you know, what advice would you give to leaders looking to more effectively align their tech and teams to improve the efficiency of their operations?
I really do think that doing an in-depth analysis and health check is critical. And you can't do this just whenever you are in a deficit and stressed out and where's the money? We have to get it fast, right? But proactively do a health check. I've had some great and been involved in some really great conversations recently with large healthcare systems, with private practices, with so many various sizes and specialties of, let's do a health check. Here's what we're finding. Well, our revenue is great. Right? Our revenue is on par with where it's been the last 2 years. But when you do a health check and you figure out by CPT level, by doctor, by denial type, when you do an analysis that goes into that level of detail, it is just incredible to me every single time what you can find and where your deficits are. Do a health check. Don't wait until you're struggling and you're being reactive. Do a health check. Make sure that you're looking at your data in various different ways. Set it up with your KPIs, right? Find the KPIs that matter to you and that are impactful for your practice, for your organization, and research your data. and figure out what's living in there that is either positively or negatively impacting your KPIs. Again, I think that sometimes it's done in just a very reactive approach, and that's great. You can see some great turnaround on things, but when you do it proactively, it saves you and your team a lot of stress. So
exactly,
I really strongly do recommend the health checks. Do an in-depth one. Look at everything from various angles. It's like buying a car, right? You're not just going to look in the interior and say, I love that, sign me up, right? There's so many different ways that you have to look at it before you agree that you are on track and that things are going smoothly.
Yeah, and it helps uncover what are some of the issues that you may not see blatantly in front of you. Sometimes we can have blinders on when we're dealing with certain denials. We can even get into a rut of a routine of this is how we've always done it. So a lot of right. times that health check can reveal,
yes.
you know, some other things like, you know, the aging problems. And I know that we do that here at Infinix. We offer, you know, a health check. It's just a one-time, it's not an ongoing commitment. You don't have to buy a whole platform, but it's just an analysis of really doing a check of your RCM, you know, what's in the health of that RCM. So more than
You're
happy.
Exactly,
it's been
right.
very effective for a lot of people over the years.
Yep. Yeah. I think that people would be very surprised in knowing, you know, you nailed it when you said, this is just the way it's always been, right? We've always received those. We've always had those, no problem. But when you have people that come together and they're like, okay, look, but this is the knowledge we have, and this is how we know how to get rid of this. And sharing that information with the groups that do a health check through us. And it's just, I love the conversation that I've been a part of. And I love that we do that here. And it is, you know, not to just bandwagon the heck out of this thing, but it is one of the most in-depth that I've seen. And I've learned a lot from those.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's awesome. I can't highly recommend it.
Definitely.
So with that, we're going to open it up for questions. Do have one here, Christina. It's kind of a crystal ball question, if you will. So we have to kind of look in the future here. But what are the emerging trends at the intersection of technology and consultation that you believe will have the biggest impact on the healthcare industry in the next few years?
Oh, gosh.
I know.
I think that it's so much to try to unpack, right? I think that the understanding where technology is going, don't fight it, gotta accept it, right? That's the direction mm-hmm. that we're moving. And how can you appropriately utilize that? It's incredible what technology is able to do. And it's incredible how taking an approach of what are you doing manually right now, right? What are you doing so often that is second nature? And where is my technology that says they can do the same thing? And how do those two marry up? Right. And I have those conversations all the time with, what are you doing? What do you spend your time doing? What are you doing most of? What drives you crazy that you're doing manually? And here's how this product can do this for you and automate it. Mm-hmm. And it's not, like you said before, it's not to take you out of the picture because you're needed. But there's so much more that you could be doing if you didn't have to flip the E&M and EKG charge manually, right? Let's automate that. Let's set that template up to do it automatically.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that embracing it, understanding what the technology is doing and how it's advancing and trying to stay up with that, because I strongly don't believe that you want to be on the retroactive end, mm-hmm. the advancements of technology. You don't want to be playing catch up, because
right.
I think that will really set you back years in a very fast paced way.
Oh, and I agree, because I mean, and we mentioned
let's set that template up to do it automatically.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that embracing it, understanding what the technology is doing and how it's advancing and trying to stay up with that, because I strongly don't believe that you want to be on the retroactive end, mm-hmm. the advancements of technology. You don't want to be playing catch up, because
right.
I think that will really set you back years in a very fast paced way.
Oh, and I agree, because I mean, and we mentioned AI. AI is everywhere, artificial intelligence, and everyone's all the buzz, but it really is something when it used to be called machine learning. the machine learning was, it seems like the phrase has changed over the years, but it is where technology is now getting to the point where it can actually learn behaviors. It can learn payer behaviors. It can learn even coder behaviors. You may have one super coder and one coder's at entry level, but then they can share that experience through that machine learning. I really see that as being a big impact. And then that can be catered into where your automation can be automatically automated. Automate your
Yes,
automation.
that's exactly right.
It's almost like it can just get better and better and better to where it's just learning on its own, but it enhances the job of the coder, the job of the builder, because there are instances that are just, like, and you mentioned it earlier, mundane, rudimentary things that just eat up your time over and over and over again. There may be a more complex case. And actually, if you look at an EHR, I think one company that I know very well did a survey, and they found that most data that comes from an EHR, about 30% is correct, but yet a coder's looking at it. So
Yes.
that's a waste of time. If it's correct, why are you looking at it? So that's a third of the work that's already done. So now you can
Yes.
focus on more efficient things. And then there's a certain percentage that's automated. Again, we're just maximizing the number of encounters a coder can actually perform on an hourly basis, on a daily basis. It just increases that workload, but it makes the workload easier as well. So
That's exactly right.
that's my soapbox. So we do have another we do have another question here. It says, can you provide more color on the RCM health check? How do you run that check with clients, and what data do you use?
Yep. So the health checks that I've been a part of, and I think that there's multiple levels. I'm sure that I will receive a text if I am speaking incorrectly here, but your charges, your payments, your adjustments, and most of these are canned reports that live within an EMR and a clearinghouse. So we ask for at least a year of data. More is better, right? Anything that we can get that gives us kind of a historical look at where you've been and where you need to be. So we look at the size. How many physicians do you have? How many PAs, MAs, NPs do you have? What's your patient volume? What's your CPT volume? So we look at your charges, your payments, your CAS codes, all of your remits. We look at all of the adjustments that are existing in your AR. We take all of that. We put it all together. We put it into our health check system, and it has an output for us that tells us here's where your NCR is, here's where your average charge amount is, your average collections. And then based on your specialty and practice size, it shows us where some kind of immediate yellow and red flags are. Okay. If you're billing out these pets and nukes and you're not getting payment on those, big red flag, right? And then we're able to go into that because we've pulled your remit data. We're able to go in and see what went on the claim, what came back on your remit, what is the responses that you're getting, and how can we guide you? How can we try to take a consultative approach to it and saying, here's where we see some deficits. Here's what we recommend. Here's what we see, right? Here's how we get this paid. So that's kind of a quick,
Yeah, that was
fast way of
great.
explaining that.
All the detail, the better detail the possible, because a lot of people don't think about, your balance sheet, how important that is. And your denials come in through the remittance, but also what's your AR look like? That's not on your remittance advice notice. That's you get that
That's
from
exactly right.
your
And a
balance
lot of
sheet.
people
So
don't think, why do my contractual adjustments matter? Right? Why do you care what I'm writing off to my contractual? So that's a big part of it, right?
yeah.
We want to see all of it so that we can not only we don't want to give you a fraction of what we believe might need to happen or what is going on. We want the whole picture. So the more data we can get, the better, because it's going to help us paint a better picture of what's going on and how we can maybe guide some assistance there.
Awesome. Well, we don't have any other questions. That wraps up this episode of Office Hours. Christina, I want to thank you for coming on today. Y'all stay tuned. She's going to be back for